You know, let me just get right into it. We last week something happened. If you weren't here or if you weren't at the service or if you're brand new, if you're visiting here, I want to just give you a little background so that you'll be up to speed. We had someone during worship speaking in tongues, which is part of worship in certain settings. And there was someone else who came up here, and I think I mentioned her name last week, so I'm going to mention her name again this week, Vicki, who I know, who I've spent some time with, and I know where she's at, and she's very vague. If I think I could be honest enough to say, she didn't believe in the gifts. And that's okay. You don't have to do that to be here. You just, anybody comes in the door. But God did an amazing thing in her life. While that was taking place, God gave her the interpretation of what was being said. And she came up to me with this deer in the headlights look and says, what do I do? What does that mean? I don't get it. And all week, we just had lunch again yesterday, Saturday, and she told me, I don't know what God wants, why he's doing that. And I told her some of the beliefs that I thought. I think God was trying to get to her in a way that she would understand. Because sometimes we put so many walls up in front of God. They're cultural walls, they're personal walls, they're bad things that have happened in the past walls, so I'm not gonna let that happen. And those walls can also include the things that God wants to do in a person's life. And so I was very excited, and I thought today we might just follow up on that, and I wanted to do more of a teaching today. And so, you know, there's not probably gonna be a lot of hallelujahs and amens, that's okay. But I do want you to allow yourself to be open to the teaching of God. Now, I'm not going to go by what the Baptists believe or what the Pentecostal believe. I'm not going to go by what the Methodists believe or the Presbyterians or any book that you may have read. We're going to look right at Scripture. Because the best way to interpret Scripture is how? Through Scripture. It interprets itself. Now, don't get me wrong, there's some hard things in Scripture to understand. And to say that you've got a take on all that, then you come up here and preach, because I don't. But there's some things that you can't misunderstand. And I don't think, by looking through the text, and I hope today you can come to that same conclusion, that we can misunderstand what spiritual gifts are, and what their use is, and what they're for, and why they're available today, and when they should be used, and how they should be used, and the benefit and the profit that comes to you or comes to an assembly when they're used in a corporate setting like they were today. And so I want to talk a little bit about that, but again, we're going to look totally at Scripture. So if you're willing to do that, look at your neighbor and say, let's go for a ride. There is a whole section, as many of you know, on the gifts of the Spirit. And it's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 all the way through 1 Corinthians chapter 14. Even 13 is the love chapter, but it mentions some of that. And the first verse in chapter 12 says this. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I do not want you to be ignorant. Now this is Paul speaking to a Corinthian church who many of you know, and if you don't, they were a jacked up church. They had a lot of things that they were ignorant about. And ignorant in our culture means a bad word. It's like you're dumb and you're stupid. But ignorant means you don't have the information. Some of your text may see, I don't want you to be uninformed. I think the NIV puts it that way. I don't want you to be uninformed about spiritual gifts. I want you to have an understanding, because there were some things that were going on in that church that weren't godly, that weren't right. And Paul comes in and says, hey, let me set things aright for you. Let me put things aright. Now, in this Corinthian church, we know that they were ignorant about a lot of things. In chapters 1 through 3, they were ignorant about unity. They celebrated more division than they did unity. And Paul, through the Holy Spirit speaking, and says, you know, everything that you do should be to unify one another, not to push one another away, not to set one person up on a pedestal and not another, not to compete with others in different things, spiritual gifts included. They were confused and they were ignorant about immorality. In chapter 5, the scripture in there that many people know, they may not know any of scripture, but they know about that guy who slept with his mother or his stepmother, and how Paul said, you guys aren't doing nothing about that? That is wrong, and you should judge that. So don't say there's not judgment in the church. Those things should be judged because they've already been prejudged. Well, they were ignorant about that. They didn't know how to handle that. They didn't know what to do with that. They didn't know how to approach that. In chapter 8, they were ignorant and uninformed about marriage. When should I give my daughter away? How should, you know, is it okay to do it? Should I keep her a virgin? Blah, blah, blah. And they were just ignorant. They were uninformed. They did not have the information about these things. And in chapter 9, they were ignorant and uninformed about love and knowledge. And that's where Paul teaches them. He says, listen, love builds up, but knowledge puffs up. Knowledge is like a cheese puff. It looks good on the outside and it's tasty, but there ain't nothing in it. You chew it and it's gone. And that's what knowledge is. And they were trying to celebrate these things. In chapter 10, they were ignorant and uninformed about idolatry. They were thinking that you could serve God and that you could also serve idols, things that were not of God, things that God drew them out of. And so they didn't have the information about that. And one of the things I get from this is, you know, God doesn't kick them to the curb, says, you bunch of ignorant fools. No, he sends Paul speaking through the Holy Spirit and says, listen, there's some things here, and I want to correct you on them. And so he begins to do that. In chapter 11, what we just did this morning, they were ignorant about communion. They would get together in their communion time, and they would have a fellowship meal. And they would sit down, and it would be a meal with one another. And he's like, that's not what communion is for. It's for a remembrance. It's for understanding what God has done in your life. And so it makes perfect sense, to me anyways, that in chapter 12, they were ignorant about spiritual gifts. They were ignorant about the things that God had said, I want to use you for, and the things that I want to give you. A.W. Tozer wrote a quote, and I'm going to read it to you. He's a pastor, and he's an author. I think he passed away back in the 60s. But he said this, the idea of the Holy Spirit to the average church member is so vague as to be non-existent. Do you think that's true? Do you think that's true in your life, in our church, in the churches in America? I'm asking you. This is a relatable sermon today. You think that's true? Do you think Paul could be speaking to the 2024 church and say, I don't want you to be ignorant. I don't want you to not have the information. I want you to understand these beautiful things that God has for you and the way they're supposed to be used and what they're for and how they profit you and how they build you up. Do you think that that statement is true in your life? That the Holy Spirit is basically non-existent in your life? We could talk about the Holy Spirit. We can mention his name. We can feel spiritual about it. But what does the Holy Spirit do? How does he work? And so we want to look at this, and I'm going to go through chapters 12 and 13, and we're going to land on chapter 14. We're going to go through these kind of quick because I really want to get into what happened last week and what happened this morning, the gift of tongues and prophecy and interpretation of tongues. And I think it's important. I can remember, and I've grew up Pentecostal all my life, you know, there's about 3 or 4 sermons in a person's life that you can remember. At least I can. You know, there's been some great sermons that I've heard, and those are the ones I remember. I've heard a gazillion sermons. That's why I'm like, when you guys go out of here, 99% of you aren't even remember what was said. But the Spirit of God has the ability to take his word, place it on your heart, and to remember it. And I hope today is one of those. I hope today is one of those sermons. You say, well, I'm a little leery of the Holy Spirit. We're going to get into that. Don't worry about that. The reason why people are leery about the Holy Spirit is because there are people who are called cessationalists. I think I pronounced that right. Basically, it means they believe the Holy Spirit has ceased. The gifts have ceased. And they use 1 Corinthians 13, chapter 8, where it says, when perfection has come, let me read it to you. When perfection has come, we know in part and we prophesy in part. When that which is perfect has come, that which is in part will be done away with. And many people equate that to the gifts of the Spirit that he had just referenced in chapter 12. But Perfection hasn't come to the assembly yet. We don't live in a perfect state. Jesus was perfect and he came, absolutely. But it's talking about the second coming because we don't need these gifts at the second coming. We don't need to speak in tongues to have this vocabulary that God gives us. We don't need an interpretation. We don't need prophecy because we'll be with him. As the scripture says, we will see him face to face. It won't be dimly in a mirror. And because of that, so many people are afraid. They're afraid to take the step and say, I don't know, is there a gift for me? Is there something for me? And a lot of times they're afraid. They're afraid because of the sensationalist. And you know what they are? They're the ones who have to have a charismatic flair in every service. If you don't have enough tongues, if you don't have enough healings, if you don't have enough of this or that, well, then God's just not in your midst. And it runs people away from the reality and the truth about the Holy Spirit and the gifts of the Holy Spirit and how he wants to use them through you and why he wants to use them through you. I mean, there's a purpose to this. It's not just to say, we got it and you don't. There's a real purpose. God doesn't do anything haphazardly. And so he gives you the gift of peace. Thank God for that. Well, he gives many other gifts. And that's what Paul is talking about here in chapter 12. And he's saying, listen, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of anything God wants to give you. If it's a promise in the New Testament, it's for you. Don't be afraid of it. You're not afraid of peace. You're not afraid of salvation if you surrendered your life to Christ. Don't be afraid of the other things that he wants to get. It's like Christmas. You're going to get that one great toy that you want to open when you're a kid, and then you start opening the clothes, all the dumb stuff that you really didn't want for Christmas because you wanted more toys. Hello? Am I talking to anybody today? But those are necessary gifts, those clothes. I'm glad my mom bought them for me. I was able to go to school not naked. I didn't get kicked out. Hallelujah. What if we looked at the gifts of God that way? The big gift of salvation. Oh, my goodness, the gift of peace that we so always need. But what about the gift of prophecy and the gift of the word of wisdom and word of knowledge and of helps? And you can find the complete list of all the gifts if you look, and I encourage you to do this. Don't just take my opinion for it. Don't just take what I'm commenting on scripture for it. But in Romans chapter 12, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, 1 Corinthians chapter 13 and 14, which is where we're at today, take a look at those gifts and see maybe and pray maybe about how can God use these things through me? Does God want to use these things through me? And if you're a sensationalist, and I don't think we have anybody in here, but just in case you're on that line, I want you to look up Proverbs 19:2. It's not good to have zeal without knowledge, nor be hasty and miss the way. So often as a sensationalist, we're so in love with God, and we are. I'm not knocking any of that. But we do it haphazardly and hastily, and we actually miss the purpose of the gifts. We miss the reason of the gifts. We miss what God wants to do. And I don't know about you. I think I can say pretty much confidently this, but I don't think any of us want to miss out on God. I don't think anybody wants to miss what God wants to do amongst this assembly and as it continues to grow. I can't believe that. And I don't think you can either. And so let's really take a look at some of these things through Scripture and understand that it is important to not be afraid. Verse 4 in chapter 12, Paul says, through the Spirit of God speaking, I always reference that because sometimes when we say Paul wrote and we think that it was Paul. Well, it wasn't Paul's intellect. It wasn't his wisdom. It wasn't his schooling all his life, even though he was a smart man. It was because 1 Peter 1:21, the Holy Spirit carried along holy men, and he gave them the word of God. And there's other scriptures, 2 Timothy 3:16, all scriptures God breathed. So it came through God into men in order to give to us. And this is what we have, the inerrant word of God. And so he says in verse 4, there's a diversity of gifts. There's a bunch of different kinds of gifts. And those gifts are found in that list that I spoke just a minute ago. But chapter 12 continues with, I don't want you to be dumb. I don't want you to be ignorant or uninformed. I want you to be informed. And the first thing he goes to is unity. The first thing he says is, listen, he compares the body, the assembly, as a body, as a human physical body. He says, you can't take one part out and leave the other and expect to be whole. And all of the body, all of the assembly can't just be a head or a foot, because where would all the other activities be? It would be non-existent. But he has placed every part in the body as he sees fit. Then he talks about the unmentionable parts. We even give greater modesty to them. And so unity is what he's saying when he first talks about, I don't want you to be ignorant about spiritual gifts. Understand that spiritual gifts have to be a unity within the body. They're part of the body of God. And he goes through that, and he gets to chapter, or the last verse in chapter 12. Man, I went through that chapter quick, didn't I? Whew. Chapter 12 says this, verse 31. But earnestly desire the best gifts, and yet I will show you a more excellent way. Well, what are the best gifts? I mean, it's not love, because love, he says, I'm going to show you a more excellent way, and that's when he gets into love. What are the best gifts to have? He just went over that list of, I think it's 8 through 11. What are the best gifts to have? I think in the Corinthian church, they were competing with their gifts. One had the gift of tongues, thought that they were a little bit better than the person who could only prophesy, or the person who could only have the gift of helps. And there was a competition going on, and he says, choose the best gifts. So what is the best gifts? Well, it depends. It depends on what is needed in the situation. What I mean by that is if someone needs instruction or someone needs some insight, then prophecy is the best gift to use that we would pray God would use us for. If somebody needs direction and they don't know what to do, then a word of wisdom would be a gift that we would pray for and desire, earnestly desire the best gifts, so that we could impart wisdom to another person. You see, the gifts aren't about you. The gifts are about us. What about tongues? That gift is about us. If someone needed to speak to God, and we're going to get into what that means here a little bit, but to have that vocabulary and that connection with God that can't be obtained through the English vocabulary. It's an unintelligible language. It's like a baby talking to its mother, yet they both know what they mean. If someone needs that in their life, why so downcast, my soul, the psalmist said. Trust in the Lord, and you need that in your life. Then tongues is a good gift. So it depends. It's not one gift is better than the other. God doesn't set things in order that way. It depends on the situation. And we're called to not be ignorant, to know what the best situation is. And so having said that, he goes into love. What is love? And he begins to talk about love. And I think it's John 7, verses 38 and 39, because I used to have a sweatshirt that said that. And I remember going fishing up in Canada with my dad when we used to do our stuff together before he passed. And he wasn't a Christian at the time. And he asked me, what's that shirt mean? And I'm like, I was a young Christian. And I'm like, man, I'm like trying to take the Bible word by word and say, this is what it means, this is what it means. And he just wanted to know what it meant. And I have come to understand that Jesus, when he said, out of your bellies as Christians will flow rivers of living water. And he was talking about the scripture teaches us the Holy Spirit. And I think there are times where the river of living water flows out of our belly and splashes on those around us. And he splashes on us with the different gifts that he's given us in order to help people in the different situations. So the best gift is to desire the best thing to use in that situation. Paul goes on to say that not everybody has every gift. It's not like we can go, Lord, I need some wisdom today. Give me a word of wisdom. No. God wants to use you, and he uses you because he created you. But out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. You are to splash on others. And then he begins to talk about chapter 13, about love, the more excellent way, another way that all of us can splash on the life of other people. Listen to what he says in verse 1. He's just kind of rebuked them about the gifts and how they were using them. He says this, though I speak with the tongues of men and angels, but I have not love, I have become a sounding brass or a clanging cymbal. In other words, I'm just a bunch of noise. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries, and I can speak those into your life, although I can do that, but I don't have love, what does he say? He goes on to say that I can understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though that I have all faith so that I can move mountains, but I have not love, he says, I am nothing. And in the Greek, nothing means nothing. Zilch, zero. I have nothing to offer a fellowship. I have nothing within me to profit, even though I might have the gift of whatever it is. But if it's not communicated, if the divine manifestations of God are not communicated with, through, and by love, then they're zilch. They mean absolutely nothing. And what an indictment. What an indictment. These beautiful things that God has given to us as a church, as an assembly, as a fellowship, to bless one another and to love one another and to support and to teach and to help one another. If we do it just because, hey, I'm smarter than you, which was what was happening there, then keep it to yourself, basically. It means absolutely nothing. He goes on down in verse chapter 13, and we're not going to spend a lot of time on love because we've talked about that before, and we'll, I'm sure, get back to that. But he says, I'm going to show you a more excellent way. And excellent in the Greek means this. It means being more useful, more serviceable, and more advantageous. So love flowing out of your belly, out of your life, out of your heart, is more advantageous than the greatest of gifts, than the greatest of your wisdom, than all your knowledge. Love is so, so much better than that. But then we get to chapter 14, and he says these things that actually, I believe, put things in perspective. He says this after talking about certain gifts, after saying there's a better way, which is love, and that's where many people stop. He says this, verse 1, pursue love and desire spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. Now, hold on there for a minute. He didn't say do one and not the other. He said chase after love, pursue love, and desire spiritual gifts. It'd be like show and tell. You show up and you tell everybody in the kindergarten class, my daddy's a fireman. And it becomes show and tell day, and you stand up there and you say, my daddy's a fireman, and your daddy don't show up. This is a call for those of you that are on the fence. We should love intently, immensely, with all that we have, body, soul, and spirit. We should love one another. But don't forget about spiritual gifts. Because through spiritual gifts is a way to love. And many people, again, as we said from the onset, Holy Spirit is non-existent. We get the love part. Everybody gets the love part. You talk to anybody in America today, Jesus loves me. Well, absolutely he loves you. If you don't think that, then you've been getting some bad 411. Of course he loves you. But as a believer and as a follower, he has things for you. It's not just, I'm going to give you, and then you exist. No, it's show and tell. Faith without works is dead. And so he gives us these gifts. And he starts to talk about particularly two gifts. And that's where we're going to end up today. He talks about prophecy, and he talks about tongues, and a little bit about the interpretation of tongues, which is what took place this morning. And he goes into depth in verses 2 and 4. I'm just going to read the whole thing through for you, and then we'll go back and break it down. It says, For he who speaks in a tongue does not speak to men, but to God, for no one understands him. However, in the Spirit, he speaks mysteries. But he who prophesies speaks edification and exhortation and comfort to men. He who speaks in a tongue edifies himself, but he who prophesies edifies the church. I wish that you all spoke in tongues, but even more that you all prophesied. So he's beginning to begin a little bit specific because of the things that were happening in the church. And he's saying, listen, prophecy within the church is preferable. Tongues within the church is acceptable, not preferable. It's acceptable as long as there's an interpretation. Prophecy is good because it edifies people. And why is prophecy within a church setting, within a fellowship setting, why is it better? Why is it more profitable? Well, he says it right in there. Because it exhorts people, it builds people up, it tells people, it cheers people up. How did he put it? That exhortation, edification, and comfort. Edification is building someone up. Exhortation is stirring someone up. Comfort is cheering someone up. And that's why the gift of prophecy specifically is good for those things. And we've seen some of that. We actually talked about it last week. What is prophecy? Well, some of it is a foretelling of what God is going to do. You remember last week we talked about Acts chapter 2 and how when Peter got up and they all began to speak in other languages, Peter got up and he quoted Joel 2 where in the last days, that tells me it's the last days because it's already happened. In the last days, I will pour out my spirit on my men servants, on my maid servants. He'll pour out his spirit on all of us. And anyone who calls on the name of the Lord, and I'm botching that scripture up a lot, but shall be saved. That was a forthtelling that the prophet Joel spoke about 870 years earlier that now is coming to fruition. You know, God's never late, is he? It's coming to fruition, and Peter is able to speak forth prophecy through that scripture and say, this is what that means. This is what it means. It means you guys need to get right with God, paraphrasing that, of course. And what happened? Well, they were cut to the heart. Prophecy changed 3,000 people that day. It edified the beginning of the birthday of the church. That's prophecy. We also read about another prophet in Acts. His name is Agabus. Agabus in Acts chapter 11 gave a prophecy that in Judea there was going to be a famine. And so the disciples who apparently had the discerning spirits, they understood what he was saying was true through God, took up a collection. And so the brothers and the sisters in the Judean church didn't suffer. You can read about that in history. They didn't suffer while the rest of people did. Yet they gave their stuff away because that's what they did. They wanted to splash love on people. You also read about Agabus in chapter 21 of Acts, where he's facing Paul, and Paul is getting ready to get on a ship, and his final destination would be Rome. And he takes Paul's belt, which more like a belt around a robe, and he takes it and he ties it to himself, and he says these words, "The man who owns this belt will be bound and sent to Rome," basically. And all the brothers that were there were crying and said, "No, Paul, you're our teacher. We love you." And Paul's like, "Dude, I know where I'm going, dude. What? Don't take my blessing from me. I want to go." And so Paul went, and you know the rest of the story. He was able to speak to so many dignitaries before he was put to death. And he enjoyed it because that's what he wanted to do. But that's what prophecy is. But prophecy is also this. It's also a forthtelling. And forthtelling means taking an established truth and manifesting it into a person's life that to where it helps them, to where it speaks into their life. What I'm doing right now is prophecy. I'm taking the word of God, not my truth, The Word of God. When Pastor Lauren or Pastor Ryder get up here, they take the Word of God and they foretell a word that speaks to some of you. How many times have people come up to me and said, man, were you reading my email? How did you know that about me? Did my wife call you? Did my husband call? I'm sorry, I don't even know your name yet. What do you mean? That's God using his word through a person with the gift of prophecy to speak into your life. And it happens all the time. And the great thing about that is it profits everybody. Now, I dare say, if I gave you a scheme to take your money and put it in this shady bank account and tell you that you're going to get 82% interest if you leave it in there for 3 years. I'm just making that up. That's not true. But if I told you that and you believe me as a prophet, you'd do it. And in 3 years, you would have a prophet. You'd have a big prophet. Well, the word prophet here in Corinthians is the same thing. Builds up. It's like building your account, building your spiritual account. It profits you. It profits the whole congregation. And it's necessary. And that's why God gave us, the church, this gift to use as speaking forth edification, as he said, exhortation, comfort, so that we can do all those things amongst each other. Now, prophecy can be convicting, but it's never condemning. So when you see the guy on the street corner with the bullhorn saying, you're going to hell if you don't come to Jesus, that's not prophecy. That's somebody's passion. They're passionate about Jesus. They're passionate about people. They're just doing it the wrong way. Prophecy can be convicting because, again, we go back to Acts 2. When Peter read that scripture in Joel, the Bible says they were cut to the heart. They were convicted. And they said, what must we do, brother? And he said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you and your household will be saved. And it's no different today when prophecy is spoken forth. Maybe it's spoken forth after the service and a couple of you are gathered together and you say, man, you know, Pastor Butch said this word of scripture and this is really how it applied to me. And you say, man, that applies to me too. I need that too. Well, you're prophesying. And that's what God says through his word is the best gift or the most important gift amongst the assembly. And so now he begins to tell us about a directional difference. He begins to talk to us about tongues. Now, tongues is, and I'm sure there are better people that can explain it than I can, but this is how I explain it, and I've done so much research on it. I didn't believe it. You know my story. We went to a Pentecostal church. I love the church. I love the people. It was almost as good as this church, and I mean that. There's some people that were in that church that are in this church. It was just so good. I just didn't get it. I can't say that I was afraid because I usually face things head on with anything in life. But I just didn't get it, and I didn't want it. And it was cool for them, but just not cool for me. Hey, God bless you. You do you. And then it happened to me, and it wasn't because anybody was praying for me or anybody gave me a formula or anybody said, just say these words. No, I was in my truck on 66 coming home from a place I worked in Fairfax all by myself without a radio, and I was singing the worship songs that we had sung the Sunday before. And these words began to flow out of my mouth. And I said, oh my gosh, it is true. I got a lot of apologizing to do. It's true. It's a gift that God had that he wanted to give to me. And the gift is for connecting with God. That's the direction. It's from man to God. That's what tongues is. Tongues is man to God. It's never a message in tongues. There'll never be, and I will let you know if it is wrong, within the assembly, somebody stand up and speak in tongues and somebody say, God wants you to know that you're doing this, this, and this, and he sees that. No. You remember last week when I told you Vicky came up to me? She gave me the interpretation, and it's a perfect interpretation. And here's what she said, and I'm going to repeat it as she told me. It says this, in God we worship. Praise, glory, praise, and worship. I am here. Because that's what tongues is. Tongues is for prayer, private prayer, and it's for worship. It's for connecting with God in a way that you just don't have the ability to do. Have you ever had a joy in your heart that at that moment you just stood in awe because words escaped you? Well, God gives us words when we are in awe of him so that we can worship him, speak directly to him. 1 Corinthians 13:1, if I speak with the tongues of men and angels, we speak to him, and it's unintelligible. Nobody knows what you're saying. You don't know what you're saying. Now, again, and let me emphasize, if it's done in the church, there must be an interpretation. There should be no such thing as somebody over here and somebody over here and somebody over here during worship bellowing out in tongues because they're worshiping God, and they are. They truly are. What they're saying is right. Paul goes on to say that. But within the church setting, he says, if people who are in there who are uninformed, who are ignorant of who Christ is, then they think you're all knuckleheads. I'm paraphrasing that. They think you're nuts. They think you're like, what is going on in this place? Should we leave now, or should we be respectful enough to leave at the end of the service? I've been in some of those services. But the purpose of it is to pray in a language, a prayer language, as I told you last week, what I call my soul language. That's down deep. You know, we're a three-part person, body, soul, and spirit. So why can't we talk to God with body, soul, and spirit? And he goes on to say that this is that's what tongues is. It's directed to God. Prophecy is directed from God to man. That's what we're doing now. Prophesying on the word of God. We're commenting and doing a commentary on the word of God. And this is pretty explainable. There's not a whole lot of fluff that you can put in that. He says it basically. He says, I wish you all spoke with tongues, but even more that you prophesied, for he who prophesies is greater than he who speaks in tongues, unless he interprets that the church might receive edification. Exclamation point. And so my whole purpose for this is not to put a downer on the gifts. Oh, it's the complete opposite. I want us to begin to use the gifts, and I want us to begin to use them in a right way. I want us to begin to understand that God has these things so that the church, so that we can be edified. God's never going to put on you anything you don't want. But you shouldn't be afraid of anything God wants to give you. Tongues, as I mentioned earlier, is that language. You know, my sister's here, by the way, and she's shorter than me, but don't tell her I said that. This is my sister. I'm so glad she's up. Please say hi to her. Don't ask her any of our stories from the past because we used to get in trouble. Her and her husband. Thank you, Tom. I forgot where I was going with that now. Oh, we were over at her daughter's house, my niece's house yesterday. They were having a birthday party for one of her three boys. There's nothing but boys in our family. Yeah. And Liam is the middle son, and he's a hoss. That dude is like thick, and he don't care nothing about nobody. And so they were sitting there at the table, and Megan, my niece, was sitting there doing her thing with all the other two kids. She's a busy lady. And Liam reaches over and grabs her, and I'm watching this as I'm drinking a cup of water. I'm watching this, and he just looks at her and says, da 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 da. And I'm like, what? And Megan's over here going, I know, baby, it's gonna be okay. I understand. And I think she understood what he was saying. I didn't have a clue. But what if that's what tongues is and can be for you? that you lay in the arms of your Father and you speak and you connect in a way that you've never connected before. And it may sound like gibberish to you, but not to him. It didn't sound like gibberish to my niece. She smiled, she hugged him and said, "I know, baby, I love you." I don't have a clue what he said. But something was said. Have I mentioned my grandson lately? I called Griffin on the phone last week. I went fishing with my brother-in-law, and I was missing family, so I didn't call Lisa. I called my grandson. And so I told Roger, I said, "Man, let me talk to Griff for a minute." And so the thing flips up, and he looks at me. He goes, "Hiya!" And then he starts going, "Hi, no, 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 toe, 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 toe." And then he starts doing this. He goes, "Well, you know, I knew what that meant, because every time I get on the iPad with him, I do the whole turkey thing." And every time I do that, he just cackles from his belly. We're connecting. We're communicating. He doesn't have a clue what I'm doing. I don't have a clue what he's doing, but I know he wants me to do that. And so allow tongues to be a gift that, if God wants you to have that as a prayer language, then receive it and enjoy it, because that's what it's for. It's that ability to talk in a very intimate type of way. And again, it's preferable in your private prayer life. It's acceptable in the church as long as there's an interpretation. He goes on to say, you know, another thing about tongues I forgot to mention is tongues as a message or as a prayer, you can look these up, you can write these scriptures down. Ephesians chapter 6, where Paul is speaking and he's talking about the whole armor of God, that we're to put on the armor of God. And at the end of that, he says, pray in the Spirit always. And Jude, which is at the end of the Bible, only has one chapter, around verse 20, he says, build yourself up in your most holy faith. So tongues is for edification, but it's for you personally. It's not for the church corporately. And that's why prophecy is better in the church than tongues. It's not forbid. We don't say you can't do it. That would be against scripture. But we do say do it right and in order and in decency. And there always has to be an interpretation. Romans 8:26 says, in the same way, the Spirit helps us pray in our weakness, for we do not know what we should pray, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us. That's your soul language, your prayer language. In Acts chapter 2 and chapter 10, we see where they spoke in tongues and they heard the wonderful things of God. In Acts chapter 10, where the Gentiles, those who weren't Jewish believers, received the Holy Spirit, Paul came and said, have you received the Holy Spirit? And they said, we didn't even know there was such a thing. Kind of like the American church. We didn't even know there was such a thing as the Holy Spirit. So he laid hands on them and prayed, and they began to magnify, the Bible says, they began to magnify God. And so tongues is for worship. Tongues is for prayer. But again, specifically, privately, it's directed to God, and it profits you. And why wouldn't you want something to profit you? Prophecy is directed to the assembly, and it profits everybody. And why wouldn't we want everybody to be profited? Why wouldn't we want everybody to be built up in their most holy faith? I'm going to move on because I probably ain't going to be able to finish this, but verse 6 says, but now, brethren, when I come to you speaking with a tongue, what shall I profit you? Again, profit, that word. Unless I speak to you either by revelation or knowledge, by prophesying or by teaching, even things without life, without like a flute or a harp, when they make a sound, unless they make a distinction in the words, how shall it be known what is piped or played? Now, he's beginning to take and talk to their intelligence now. He says, I want you to reason with me. Take a look at this. You understand that things that don't even breathe, they don't have life within them. You understand that when they're played, you can understand if it's played right or not. And so I asked Pastor Lauren and a couple of other worship team to come up and help me with this. I want to give you an illustration on this. you guys would come on up. If you understand this, what they're about to be played, clap along with it, sing along with it. Understood the message that that brought. A lifeless instrument that has no breath in it can draw your attention, can bring you to an understanding, can speak and teach you. But it also has the ability to do the opposite. Wow. Please stop.
Make him stop. Make him stop.
Okay.
Thank you.
He's really improving.
He's still practicing, y'all. But I want to speak to your intelligence. Do you understand how the gift of prophecy and the gift of tongues works? Prophecy speaks to everybody. You get it. You understand the message. It draws your attention. Tongues within the corporate setting, well, does that. If there's not an interpretation. Paul even says later in verse 14 that in your meetings, tongues should be limited. You shouldn't have a tongue every service. You shouldn't get up. And if you do, it should be three, no more than four. If you prophesy, you can do that in sequence. So there's rules for it, and there's ways so that it doesn't sound like what was just played into the ears of people that might be in here. But it sounds like what was played and understood by what was played by the people that are in here. That song crosses generational lines, so do the gifts of the Spirit. They cross generational lines, and that's what they're for, the gift of prophecy and the gift of tongues. And I'll close here. He goes on to say down in verse 13, he goes on to say, so what's the conclusion? What did we come to now that we understand that lifeless things can get our attention? So how much more do we who have life, the life of Christ, get the attention of people when we play the right sound? He goes on to say, what's the conclusion to all this? I will speak in tongues, and I will pray in tongues. I will pray in the Spirit, and I will speak in the Spirit. Notice what he said. I will, four times, which means this. And here's why so many people are afraid of it. Because some of you are thinking that, you know, you're going to be in Walmart, and you're going to be buying your groceries, And you're going to see somebody over there, checking out that you know from church. And you go to say hi, and you're going to, shandaladadoodidee, the watermelon, hallelujah. And they're going to go, thus says the Lord, right in the middle of Walmart. Well, it doesn't work that way, okay? It does not work that way. You have control over the gifts that God gives you. Remember that free will? He doesn't take his free will when it comes to his gifts either. He doesn't take it when it comes to your life. You know, you can be mad at somebody in Walmart and want to punch them, and you want to go, God's not going to put a piece of plexiglass in between you. No, my son, don't punch them. No, you have a free will to do that. So you have a will that should be exercised. As a matter of fact, the last part of chapter 14, he says, the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets, which means this. You decide. It's your choice. God has given you gifts to bless people, and you choose when to use them. You should use them. He's not saying don't use them. There's a proper time to use them, and there's a real setting to use them, but you choose them so that what is done for the community, or what is done privately in your prayer language is done for you so that everybody can be built up. Verse 18, he concludes with, I'm glad that I speak in tongues more than you all, but you never see anything in Scripture where Paul is speaking in tongues. All the meetings he was in, all the things that he did, you never see it referenced in Scripture. But apparently he did, so where did he do it? In his private prayer language, in his devotion to God, in his prayer and his worship to God. And so I want to leave you with an illustration. I went a little long today, and I'm not sorry, because we need to get this. We need to understand, because God is going to do some things when we allow him to do some things in our life. And one of the things that he's given us is to bless and love and to serve and to help, to have faith and to prophesy and to give words of wisdom, words of knowledge to each other so that we build each other up. Because if we don't, all we're doing is coming in here on a Sunday morning and having a service and going home. Maybe you're part of a small group, and if you're not, you should be. It's got to be more than that. The Holy Spirit has to be more than just that. Because if that's all he is, I can get that anywhere. I can get a feel-good anywhere. I can do a performance anywhere. But the truth of the Word of God affecting and grabbing the attention of my life so that I might pour out, and it might splash over into the lives of other people, especially those who I love that sit beside me in the assembly. I'm going to leave you with this. And this is a question that you guys can, I want you to talk back to me, because I'm going to ask you a question. If I had $1 million in my pocket, well, first of all, you'd be saying we pay you too much. And you're right. But if I did, I had $1 million check in my pocket. What are those checks that are good? Cashier's check. So you knew it wasn't just from my personal account. And I said, I held it up. And I said, God said for me to give this to someone today. But you have to do something. I can't tell you what to do. But you have to do something. And some of you in here that are bold would speak out in a service like this and say, give us a hint. Or, will it fit in the bread basket? Give us the first and the last letter of the thing that we got to do so that maybe we can get up on it, you know, a little bit. Some of you that are a little bit more sheepish and sly, and not sly, but sheepish and quiet, might come to me after the service and say, Pastor Butch, man, I could really use that $1 million. I just don't know what to do. I mean, you want me to come and work at the church? You want me to clean your office? You want me to, you know, you can come up with a variety of things. And my answer to both groups would be this. Here's what you need to do. Ask. Simply ask. We don't think about that. We think about all the things we got to do in order to please God and to get it. But he said in his word, just ask and receive. And so this morning, as we go in your seat, and we'll do what we did last week, just make an altar at your seat. If you need prayer, we'll be up here and available after service. But let's ask the reverse of what Paul was saying. Paul said, pursue spiritual gifts, or pursue love and desire spiritual gifts. Make that a commitment in your altar right now. God, I want to have the desire. Maybe you've never had the desire to have a spiritual gift because it's just, you don't get it. I hope by today I have painstakingly presented at least two. We'll do another sermon series on all of them. Help me to be a person of love. I want that. And all I got to do is ask. Well, I'm asking. Ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door will be open to you. What if we prayed what Paul said? Not only to desire spiritual gifts, but to exercise in those gifts. I don't want you to be ignorant. I want you to do these things. What if we prayed, God, help me do that? And so right now in your chair, bow your heads, close your eyes. I'm going to pray. When you get done praying the prayer that you're going to pray, you feel free to leave. Have a great day. We hope you enjoy some hamburgers and hot dogs and family. Just have a great day. But take that with you. Take the prayer that you're saying right now in your heart, speaking to God. Take it with you. Father, thank you for this day. Thank you, Lord, that there are things within your word that are difficult. And because of denominations and because of different ideas we have, they're hard to grasp when we get down to the brass tacks of your word. But I don't want to be ignorant, Lord. I don't want to not have the information. I don't want to be unprofitable for the kingdom of God. So help me to desire spiritual gifts. Let it be a passion that is within me, and help me to know the proper and the right way to use those gifts, that I might be a blessing to others, that I might pour out the Spirit of God from within me and splash on the lives of others. Would you allow me, would you open the door to do that? I earnestly desire the best gifts at the right time. That's my prayer. I can't manufacture it. It has to come from you. Help me to pursue love. Help me to find this prayer language. Help me to be intelligent and knowledgeable about the things you have left for me. I celebrate your peace. I celebrate the salvation you've brought to me. I want to celebrate the gifts that you give. Lord, that's our prayer. We thank you for hearing us. I thank you for the interpretation last week where Vicky said, I am here. Talking about you. You were with us. You are with us. Thank you for bringing that reality closer to us. And Lord, we love you and we praise you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray.